Hello everyone, this is Sam Spade, and in this tutorial we're going to make some changes to our cellular automata function so that it generates islands. This tutorial will build on the prior one about procedural generation and cellular automata, so if you haven't already watched that tutorial, make sure to watch it before this one. There's a link in the top right. Assuming you have watched that tutorial, remember that cellular automata are a grid of cells where each cell has a state, and that state changes over time based upon a given rule set and the state of the cell's neighbors. Now what we're going to do is make a couple of modifications so that we can generate some islands. Primarily, we're going to change what type of data is stored by our cells, how we count the cell's neighbors, and of course, most importantly, the rules we use to modify future generations. But let's switch over to GameMaker. I'm going to start with some quick project overview. I've put the room and objects from the last tutorial into this folder. We still have our cellular automata scripts, and we're still using the same sprite, but I've created a new room, same dimension, 600 by 600, and put our cellular automata island manager in it. I'll go over both of these objects, but first let's cover how we've changed our cellular automata script. I've kept the old one, so everything still works from the prior tutorial if you get the source code. And here is our new one. You'll notice right away that we don't have as many variables. We just have width, height, and spawn chance. Internally, it looks pretty much the same though. We set some variables. Now we only have to set width and height. We create our island, and then we randomize it. And then we have our iteration function. Creating an island is a little bit different. I create the first array with array create, and then I loop through that array and create all the internal or nested arrays, again with array create. And the reason we're initializing the grid this way is because I want to give the grid a default value. I want that value to be zero, and I want every cell to have that as a default value. So after we create our map, we then need to randomize it. We'll use a double for loop, but the part I want to point out here is that I'm leaving the edges alone. So I'm starting at 5 and going the width minus 5, or less than width minus 5, and 5 and less than height minus 5. So this is going to create a central rectangle, and only in that central rectangle are we going to spawn things. And here you'll notice that we've changed the value that we're storing. In the prior tutorial, we simply stored true or false, which is 0 or 1. Now we're going to store a range of numbers. So 0 will be the default value, and that'll be along the edges. But then inside that rectangle, if the spawn chance triggers, it'll be 60. Otherwise, it's going to be 10. Now we can come down here to our iterate function. The sort of overall structure of it is identical to the one we used last time. We create a new map, then we loop through the old map and add information to our new map with the next generation of cells. And then we replace the old map with the new map. One important note, and this will make sense in just a moment, is that we need to create a fully new map. So I'm creating an entirely new grid, again, because I want that default value there. Now let's talk about how we're going to create that new generation. And you'll see something is different about this double for loop. We are starting at 1 and going to width minus 1 or height minus 1, essentially length minus 1 of that array. This ensures that we're never going to hit the outside edges of the grid. But like we talked about in the last tutorial, if we check the outside squares in our grid, we have this issue where we're going to get out of bounds errors. But if we never check these outside squares, then it doesn't matter which interior square we're going to check, we'll always be able to do the plus or minus one to a row. And this means that when we do our interior for loop to check the neighbors, we don't need to do any edge cases because we can now no longer go out of bounds. And this is why it's important to fully initialize the grid. Because when we're creating the next generation of cells, we're never going to touch those outside edges. In fact, we're never going to touch the outside edges at all. So those outside edges need to be set to something when created. And this is how we're doing it. Now, when we're checking the neighbors, I've also made a slight modification here. I'm going to use the value that a cell holds in the rules, which you'll see in a moment. But that means we can get rid of the other edge case when we're checking neighbors. We can actually check the cell itself and just add that value together. So we loop through all of the neighbors, including the cell itself, and we add all their values together. Again, it's no longer true or false, it's just a real number, starting at 0 and increasing from there. So we add up all of those numbers, then we subtract self, and this is why we don't need that edge case, we can just count the self because we're going to remove it as soon as we're done. And then we get the average by dividing neighbors by 8. And everyone is probably familiar with the plus equals and minus equals. You can also do this with divide and multiply. So this is how we're counting our neighbors. Now we can apply the rules. I am going to go over these rules, but one thing I want to stress is that they are arbitrary. I experimented with a couple different variations. Some looked a little bit like this, some looked very different. This is the one that I found worked best for what I was trying to create. But how the rules work, how the cells change over each generation is probably the most important part, or at least one of the most important parts of your cellular automata. So this is a great thing to experiment with on your own. Try changing these rules, try entirely different things to see what happens when you're going through the generations. But here, if the neighbor's value is less than 40, so if it's a low number, then the new cell is going to equal whatever it is plus a random value between 0 and neighbors minus self. This will essentially either decrease the value held by self or not allow it to increase very much. If the value is over 40, we can continue on. Then if self is greater than neighbors, in other words, if self is in general higher than the average neighbor, it's going to get a random value added to it between negative 10 and 10, so it could increase or decrease. So this will have the effect that if any cell is higher than its neighbor's average, it will sort of fluctuate there while its neighbors figure out what to do. And then if a cell is greater than or equal to 40, but is not higher than its neighbors, in other words, its neighbors are higher than it on average, it's just going to increase. So the value will go up. But you can experiment with these. In fact, I would highly recommend it. But this line basically has the effect of keeping cells that are surrounded by low cells low. This has the effect of keeping cells that are higher than all of its neighbors sort of in a state of flux. They could go up, they could go down, they could stay the same. And if a cell is not low and has higher neighbors, increasing its height. And that's really it. Our cellular automata island manager is roughly the same. The spawn island squares function is a little bit different, but otherwise we just call randomize all our cellular automata island map function, which is a constructor, so we use the keyword new, and then all our spawn island squares. This function destroys any existing island squares and then loops through our grid, this time creating a square in every single space. So in the last tutorial, we only created squares when the value was true. Now we're going to create a square in every single space, and then we're going to set that square's image blend color, so the color that square will show up as, based on its value. So that's a function internal to this square. You can look at it, but roughly, I've just figured out what these numbers are. It's going to make low values blue. There's going to be a short transition to orange or brown, and then higher values will be green. And that's really it. Let's run it. So here we have our grid, and you can see the effect of defaulting all the values to zero and then doing this internal rectangle. We're leaving these outside edges as zero. And now we're going to iterate through by pushing spacebar, and you can see that the lower values sort of drag everything down, but wherever there were higher values, those values start to grow up. And slowly they get higher and form some nice little islands. We can hit R to restart, repeat the process. And I can just do this a couple different times, which will create several different island variations. And with that, I'd highly recommend downloading the source code and experimenting with this a bit yourself. So there you go. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll probably do at least one more of these. But in the meantime, if you want to learn more about loops or structs, check out the videos down below.